Hey everybody, I'm Scott Weichel. You are listening to My Kind of Country. My guest tonight has one of the most recognizable and cherished voices in country music, along with so many of her hit songs, including Taking It Easy, Black Coffee, and the all-time classic 16th Avenue. In March, she'll be inducted into the North American Country Music Association's International Hall of Fame, and she's here tonight to visit with us. It's a pleasure to welcome Lacey J. Dalton to My Kind of Country. Lacey, how are you tonight?
Thank you, Scott. It's great to be here.
Well, it's an honor to have you, and I really appreciate you taking time. You're a busy lady, and we finally were able to get this done, and I'm so glad.
I'm so happy to talk to you, Scott, and I'm very excited about the fact that you and your show are also going to be inducted into the Hall of Fame. You are a 2017 Hall of Fame inductee with your show, My Kind of Country. Let me be the first to congratulate you.
Well, thank you so much, and let me congratulate you for being inducted into the Hall of Fame there. It's a well-deserved award.
I'm looking forward to meeting you as in real life.
I am too. It's going to be a blast. There's going to be so many great people there. We've got, of course, yourself and R. Harlan Smith and Chris Nielsen from Canada, and Donna and Leroy Anderson, also from Canada, and Gary Morris, Erlene Mandrell, Sylvia, Paulette Carlson from Highway 101, and the great Freddie Hart is getting the Legends Award. It's going to be a fantastic show.
I'm so looking forward to it. Some of these folks are dear friends that I haven't seen in a long, long time. As you know, I live out in the West, and I don't get back to Nashville very much. So it's wonderful for me to get back there and see everybody and say hello, because it only happens, I only get back there maybe, oh, once every couple of years.
Yeah, it's going to be a blast, and getting to hear everybody too. I mean, this is a lineup, and the tickets are only $20. And folks, you can get those at countrytonightpf.com, or you can call 1-800-792-4308. They are going fast. I just talked to them the other day, but it's a 1,000-seat theater, so there's still tickets available. But I encourage you to get them. It's Saturday, March 18th at 7 p.m. at the Country Tonight Theater in Pigeon Forge. Can't wait.
Well, Scott, are you going to stay there? I understand that there's an entire week of activities before we even get there on the 17th. I understand that it starts, I believe, on the 13th, and they have all kinds of other things happening. This is the 20th anniversary of that event, so I think that they are probably going to, have quite a few wonderful activities for people down there in Pigeon Forge. And let me see, week-long event, March 13th to 19th. And it says they're having entertainment and events and awards and competitions, receptions, and more. So any of the fans that want to go down there and enjoy that place from the 13th on will have a wonderful time in Pigeon Forge. And, I'm going to encourage all the fans who are listening to get down there because, they had that terrible fire. And tourism is their bread and butter. And they, in their si sister city, they had a terrible, terrible fire. And I know they're encouraging tourists to go there and to, help rebuild the economy. So if you can find it in your heart to come down there, it's a good time to help those communities in near where the fire was, and also to see your favorite stars.
Absolutely. And there is a lot of going on. The NACME website has all that information. We have that on our Facebook page too, folks. You can check that out. But yeah, there's a lot going on. And I know Sunday they're having a talent search too. So new artists, you'll want to get involved in that too. So,
Oh, that's neat.
yeah,
That's really
absolutely.
good. I didn't know that. That's what's involved with that? Do they have to sign up and send in applications and stuff, or do you have to
Yes.
be chosen, or can you just go down there and do it?
I believe it's all you have to sign up ahead of time, but all that information is available on their website. And
Wow, cool.
yeah, there's something for everybody down there. It's going to be a great show, no doubt about it. And Lacey, you have an upcoming, I know this is a ways off yet, but in 2018 you have a country cruise coming up.
We do, and that is going to be a big time. We are going to be with Alabama and Larry Gatlin and his brothers, and Mickey Gilley, Bobby Bear, Jim Stafford, Johnny Lee, Lori Morgan, T. Graham Brown, Jeannie Seely, Asleep at the Wheel. There's going to be an Elvis tribute, and of course, Lori Ann Cook from Cook, formerly from Cook and Chase, will be there. I have not seen her in years. It'll be so fun to see everybody.
Oh, yeah. What a lineup, my gosh.
It's going to be amazing, and I don't have the information in front of me about that cruise, but I know that with that kind of a lineup, it is just going to be amazing. And I think that's in, I want to say that's in March of 2018.
I know the information's on your website. It's
it
LaceyJDalton.org, and Lacey also has a Facebook page, so make sure you give her a like on there as well. You can get more information.
Yeah, and we have a fan page, too. We filled up our Facebook page to the point where there were so many people on it we couldn't have any more. So we've made a fan page, and we're kind of directing everybody to the fan page if we can, just to make sure that everybody who wants to be on it can be on it.
Well, we'll put that information on our Facebook page, too, so folks can just bop over there and stay in touch with Lacey and everything that's going on. That's fantastic. Lacey, I want to talk just a little bit about David Frizzell. You contributed to the Roundup project that he did last year, and it was a fabulous album, and I'd like to have you tell me a little more about that.
Well, I tell you, Scott, it was one of the most fun things that I've ever been able to do. We went out there, and we had a real cattle drive. We rode wonderful horses, and it was in Montana, in the most beautiful place you could ever imagine. And I always thought that a cattle drive might be kind of a drive. I like riding horses, and as you know, I have a foundation for wild horses to protect and preserve them called Let 'Em Run. And I'm a great horse lover. But I never thought that a cattle drive would be much fun because you generally ride behind the cattle in the dust. Well, not this was like the I don't know, the Prince's cruise of cattle drive. We were in grass knee deep up to the horses' knees, and the cows were not making any dust, and the scenery was absolutely beautiful, and we had such a good time. We had David Frizzell, of course, and we had Marty Haggard and Rex Allen Jr., and we just had a blast. It was so fun, and the wranglers were so skillful. And so we spent a day doing that, and then we did a wonderful, we sat on stumps around a campfire in the evening, and we all did old Western songs and just had a blast doing that. And a live concert in Montana, and the whole thing was one of the best experiences I've ever had. And of course, you know, David and his wife Jo are just the best people to work with. They're just fabulous, fabulous people, as well as incredibly talented. And as I told you earlier, I really believe that David is the person who is really carrying forward the torch of his older brother's singing style. His older brother was Lefty Frizzell, and Lefty, as you know, was the main influence on Merle Haggard's singing.
Absolutely.
You know, I know Marty can also sing that style, but Marty has a very unique style of all his own. I'm a Marty Haggard fan.
Oh, me
I mean,
too.
We traveled together this year, and it was we've done quite a few shows together, and between David and Marty and Rex and myself, we have had a wonderful experience.
Oh, that's wonderful, and we've played cuts from that wonderful project on our show, and it's called Frizzell and Friends Roundup, and you can get it at davidfrizzell.com. It's a lot of fun. You can just tell how much fun you guys had.
Oh, it was so great, and I don't know who picked the horse for me, but I had probably one of the best horses I've ever ridden, and it was just so wonderful. And then I was doing the next summer in August, I was going to do a big benefit for the wild horses here to raise money to find homes for a lot of, we have very, very many wild horses that are in long-term and short-term holding in the United States. We have more horses really in captivity than there, or at least as many as there are in the wild. And so we are always trying to find homes for these and other horses that have been abandoned or abused. And so we did a big benefit here in Washoe Valley down in Douglas County near Carson City, Nevada, which is the capital here. Mm-hmm. And I had the most wonderful time. We had the same group that was on the roundup. We also had the wonderful addition of the incredible voice of Jimmy Fortune.
Oh.
And have you had Jimmy on your show?
I have, and it was wonderful. What a nice man.
He is not only a lovely, lovely, beautiful person, but what a voice.
Oh, yeah.
I have to tell you what happened with our concert. It was 102 degrees all day long, and it was so hot, it was just miserable. And about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, I had some Indian friends there, and I asked them if they would do a prayer. They are medicine people. Mm-hmm. And I asked Elmer Atlukin and Dave Kempinen, who they brought this huge drum, a native drum that is made for spiritual purposes, for healing. And I had asked them to open our show for us with uh-huh. that drum. And around 4 o'clock, just before they performed, I asked them to do a prayer for the show, and they did. And we all had amazing performances. But when Jimmy Fortune came up, he began to sing, and at right around 4 o'clock, it became a little bit overcast, not enough to make the day unpleasant, just enough to lower the temperature about 20, maybe 25 degrees. And there was a light wind blowing, and the Sierra Nevada mountains were in the background, and the sun was beginning to set. And as Jimmy Fortune began to sing, "Oh, how great thou art," these clouds opened up, and this huge orange sunset was behind Jimmy as he was singing that song in his incredible tenor voice.
Wow.
And as he closed out the song, the cloud went back over the sun.
No kidding.
It was amazing. People are still talking about what happened at that concert, because there wasn't a dry eye in the house. He also, when Jimmy sang a song called "The Wall,"
which
is about a mother saying that her son, who died in Vietnam, was not just a name on the wall. Yeah. And his performance was, everyone that night just had the performance of their night. It was of their lives, and we raised a lot of money for the Wild Horses.
Oh,
and
wonderful.
It's actually helped us. We have a huge rescue going on right now. One of the largest and longest running sanctuaries in the United States went under in South Dakota, the ISPMB sanctuary, and 850 horses were in danger and not, you know, being fed properly, and just, you know, just they got out of hand for the people that were running it. So we're in the middle of that big rescue now, and the money that we raised at that concert and the awareness that we raised at that concert with those good people.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Is what has helped really sustain our part of saving the horses. We have saved a great many of them. There are only 520 left that we are now trying to get. The snow out there in South Dakota is so deep that the horses are walking over the fences.
Oh, my gosh.
It's 50 below and 30 below, and I have an advocate out there. Her name is Palomino Armstrong, and her website is Chili Pepper, C-H-I-L-L-Y, pepper.org, and you can see exactly what that rescue looks like if any of your listeners are interested in what happens in animal advocacy and horse rescue in a very critical and difficult situation. They're slipping all over the roads out there trying to get horses out. I got a call yesterday from one of the Palomino Armstrong's husband, Matt, is driving horses back and forth, you know, to deliver them to their homes. And he had pictures on the internet of I don't know how many big semis turned over on the road and a couple of police vehicles turned upside down. So it's bad out there in South Dakota now, and this is an extraordinary rescue that is going on. And I really have to thank all the people that were on our show in August for really raising awareness and helping people understand the critical nature of what we were doing.
Well, I have to, on behalf of my family, we are all animal lovers, as we talked before, and I want to thank you for everything that you've done to help these animals. I think that is the most wonderful thing, and I encourage any of my listeners that can help in any way, please get in touch, and it's such a wonderful cause, and thank you so much for that, Lacey. It's just wonderful.
Well, we would love it if you would like to see what we're doing. What I try to do is raise money and raise awareness for the groups that are on the ground doing the really hard work. And our group is called Let 'Em Run, and it's LETEMRUN.com. LetEmRun.com.
We will share that on our page as well.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
I appreciate that.
Well, thank you for everything you're doing. It's very near and dear to my heart, too, and I thank you so much for everything you're doing.
Well, Scott, I understand you've rescued dogs, and your brother rescues horses, so we're we're a rescuing kind of people, I guess.
Absolutely, absolutely. I'm from a long line of animal lovers, and wouldn't have it any other way. They're family to us, you know.
Thank you. Thank you for allowing me the time on this interview to even discuss it, because it's very, very important to me. It really keeps me going. It's been very, very important for a very long time. I started Let 'Em Run clear back in 2003.
That's great. Well, I want to talk a little bit about your career, too. And we were talking about your name. And when you first started recording, you weren't recording under Lacey J. Dalton. And I'd like you to tell our listeners how your name came to be.
Well, I will never forget. My name at the time was Jill Crofton. And I had married Aaron Anderson. So my name was Jill Crofton Anderson. But when I was performing under the name of Jill Crofton, and I'll never forget walking into Billy Sherrill's office, and he had kind of a nasal voice. He's the greatest producer ever. I mean, I just loved Billy. You know, nobody can remember this last name here. So they're saying Crofton and Boston and, you know, Crouton. You need to change your last name. You can keep Jill, but he said, we need you to have a name that sounds like an outlaw. Go find an outlaw name. Well, first of all, I never thought I'd have to change my name, and I hadn't. It caught me totally off guard. And there was a time when my manager and I had hotel rooms right close together where we were staying in Nashville, and we were calling a mutual friend in California because I was so angry about having to change my name that I wouldn't talk to my manager directly. I was talking through our mutual friend. But eventually it occurred to me that Billy Sherrill probably knew a little bit more about selling records than I did, and that I probably ought to come to my senses and do as he asked. He was a very, very fair man and a very, very gentle and wonderful producer, really the most amazing producer I think I've ever worked with. But he said, I came in and I said, I have the name. I said, my first guitar player's ex-wife's name was Lacey B. Walker. And I always thought if I had to change my name, I'd be Lacey B. Walker. And he said, you can't be Walker. Too many Walkers in the music business. Find another last name. So I had a wonderful friend who was a very, an amazing singer. She was a New York folk singer, and her name was Karen Dalton. And she was actually pretty much, I think she was a tribal, I think she was a Cherokee, and she was from Enid, Oklahoma, and I believe she was a tribal member. She sang like Billie Holiday.
Oh, wow.
But country blues. And she's kind of famous in France and overseas. They kind of know who she is. But she was a tremendous influence on my singing because of the way that she told me early on, she said, don't sing your songs. Talk your songs to the music. Talk them. Say, mean what you say. And I've had so many people tell me, you know, when you sing, I really believe what you're saying. That's because, and that's a lot because of what Karen Dalton taught me. First of all, you try not to sing anything you don't believe, although I have done it a few times, just, you know, for fun. But the bottom line is, if you can really believe in what you're singing, and you say it instead of sing it. In other words, instead of I'm going down to the store, you'd go, I'm going down to the store, more like you'd say it. Mm-hmm. Karen taught me that and taught me some things about phrasing. She was a very sophisticated musician and a great influence. So I took her last name to honor her, and her last name was Dalton. And, of course, that was a very famous outlaw band, the Dalton Boys.
Yeah, yeah.
So my name is entirely fake. The J in the middle is for Jill, who I've been to most of my friends. I never got my record deal till I was 36 years old, which was the scandal of the world. I mean, nobody could believe that an ancient person, 36 years old, could get a record deal. And I remember reading, it was a mixed blessing because I read in the New York Times, you know, how is it that a 36-year-old waitress is the great white hope of Nashville? And I just went, I don't know whether that's a good thing or a bad thing. But they were, nobody, I think they were so used to taking ingenues, young people, and models. I was neither one. I was 36 years old. I was a single mother. And I was very, very grateful to be picked up by Billy Sherrill. I had done I had written some songs, and I sent them to an old friend of mine who was a criminal attorney in L.A., quite a famous guy. and I just sent the record to him under the name. I had been Jill Anderson, or he knew me as Jill Cross, and I think I had married and became Jill Anderson, and I think the thing said Jill Cross and Anderson. He didn't recognize the name at first, so he didn't even hear the demo for about 6 months, and one morning he put it on when he was shaving, and I got a call instantly. He said, I'm going to fly up and get you. I'm going to come down here. I'm going to put you with the best players in L.A. We're going to make a demo and get you a record deal. And that's exactly what happened. He took me down there and had the best players, you know, Billy Joe Walker for one. I mean, he had some wonderful, wonderful players on the session. And I had a song that I'd written with my longest friend, whose name is Mary McFadden. We've been friends since we were 7 years old. And we still are very, very good, very best friends, you know, still, always. And we've written a number of songs together, but that song, Crazy Blue Eyes, is a song that started Lacey J. Dalton back in 1979.
Wow.
And I always have felt very blessed that it was that song that we wrote together that started my career. And I will be singing that at the Hall of Fame induction.
Oh, fantastic. I can't wait to hear that. That'll be fantastic.
It's neat. It was, she was at my house recovering from a divorce. And she was up in the loft in my cabin up in the Santa Cruz Mountains. I was in California. And I put on a pot of coffee, and I was working on this song. And as I was working on it, she was still sleeping. And I thought, you know, she's in a perfect place to write this song with me. So I said, Mary, come down here and have a cup of coffee and finish this song with me. together we got it written, and the rest is history.
Well, you had another pretty good song about coffee, too.
Well, you know, I wish I'd written that, but that was later on in my career. I don't think it was actually even a hit till 1992. But it was a strange song. It came late in my career. And, you know, as far as recording on big labels, I was with one of Jimmy Bowen. I was with Jimmy Bowen, was my producer, or James Stroud and Jimmy together. And my friend Evan Stevens said, I have a song I want to show you. And I remember when he showed it to me, and I said, this is a perfect song for Roseanne Cash. And he said, what are you talking about? He said, this is a perfect song for you. You're going to do this, and it's going to bring you back. Well, the song, he just knew it was a hit. He and his co-writer, Hillary Cantor, had written that song, and they were very good friends of mine. And for them to give me, at that point in my career, my career was sort of waning in Nashville, and for them to give me that song was a great sacrifice on their part, because anybody could have done it. In fact, I tried years later to get him to send it to Tina Turner, because I just could hear black coffee, blue, what me, and it would have been a huge pop hit. Well, it only went to 7 or something on the charts in the United States, but it outsold for weeks and weeks and weeks. It outsold Michael Bolton's new album and one other big star. I can't remember who it was at the time, but they were blown away by the response to this song. And that song went on to be a number one hit in just about every country in the world, because it was a dance that went with it.
Absolutely.
It was a huge dance hit.
Yep. Well, I still get a lot of requests for that song, and it's become a classic for you.
I love it. I love the song. It's an easy song to sing, and I love the fact that my friends gave it to me and let me be the one to sing it.
Oh, yeah. It's got a great groove, and I can't imagine anybody doing it better than you. So, Tina Turner, eat your heart out.
I'll bet there are probably a few people. It's, as I said, it's an easy song to sing, and it's got such an infectious beat.
Well, tell me, I just can't let this interview go by without asking you about 16th Avenue.
I was so blessed to have Billy Sherrill as my first producer. Even Stevens had a studio, the guy who wrote Black Coffee, and he and Eddie Rabbit co-wrote most of Eddie Rabbit's hits, and then even wrote Crazy in Love for Kenny Rogers and some other very big. He's got so many songs. Even has so many wonderful songs, and he's a wonderful man. I love him. But he had taken a song. He had a guy, a carpenter, working in his studio. And that carpenter was a man named Tom Schuyler, who was from Pennsylvania, like I am. And he took that song into Billy Sherrill. Billy heard the song, and he called me into the office, and he said, Lacey, I got this song for somebody. And he played the song for me, and I said, well, it better be for me. He said, it is. And, you know, Billy was one of the few people, Billy and even Stevens, oddly, were the only two people I ever knew who really knew they could call a hit before it happened on the radio. Mm-hmm. They had an instinct about it. I don't always have that instinct. Sometimes I adore a song that just is not a hit. In fact, a lot of the songs I love the best have not been hits, but I love them. But Billy and Even knew a hit. And Even had taken that song to Billy, and I did 16th Avenue, and Tom Schuyler then was such a wonderful writer. He got a record deal of his own, and he played with a band called Schuyler, No Block, and Overstreet, three of the greatest songwriters that Nashville's ever produced.
Yeah, I remember that, yep.
And they had a good run of hits. And then something happened, and somehow Tom became an executive, and I want to say he was vice president or president of RCA Records for a while. And I want to also say that I believe he was living in his car at the time that he had the hit, 16th Avenue. That may not be correct. But I believe, I mean, he went from, you know, just obscurity, just right to the top. He had been there a long time. And he's an amazing person, just an amazing person. He went on after that to become the head of the International Songwriters Association, and he is still associated with that great organization. But just a wonderful, wonderful person. And I was asked a couple of years ago, he called me and said, you know, he said, I'm being inducted into the Songwriters Hall of Fame. Will you come back and sing 16th Avenue for me? And I said, yes, I will. So I got to go back and sing his song for him. And that was a wonderful experience.
That's cool. Well, I'll tell you, that song is one of the all-time classics in country music, that hands down. You know, if there was an album of all the very best country songs, and it was the only one that could ever be done, that song's got to be on it, because it's I love it.
Well, you know, I was honored that Billboard magazine did call it one of the 100 best country songs ever.
Well, and it's well deserved. It's one of those that stands the test of time, and I've said many times, good music doesn't have an expiration date.
Well, I so wish I had written it. Doc told me, said, someday I'll show you what the money that I've made off that song, and I said, I think I'd rather not. But I'm honored. I'm so honored to have been the one to sing that song. It's such a great song, and it really is the story of so many, because thousands of people go to Nashville, and they never even get a chance. And some of them are some of the greatest singers and songwriters you have ever heard.
Oh, yeah.
For some reason, the magic just doesn't happen. Yeah. I was very, very fortunate to have people promoting me in the beginning, and who did a wonderful job. And I have to say that CBS Records at the time, and it had folks in it like Marianne McCready and Jack Lehmeyer and some of those folks in the early days, really promoted me. They really built a foundation that allows me to work. I'm 70 years old now, and I still am able to work as much as I want. I'm doing a little bit different kind of music now, but I still do all the country music along with what we like to call Americana. It's a country with also some bluegrass and some blues and some other influences in it, and it kind of opens up the gate for me to really do the kind of singing and writing that I've always wanted to do. And I have my own record company now, so I don't have to worry about anybody telling me what I can or cannot do. I no longer have to compromise half of what I do. I can do exactly the music that I want to do. And I made a CD in 2003 and refreshed it in 2006 called The Last Wild Place Anthology. I think it's the best work I've ever done. And I have about 30 songs written, and I'm getting ready to record some of those very, very soon.
Oh, fantastic.
I don't know what I'm going to call that, but it's a little different from country music, but my country fans really seem to like it. So, and I often work now as a duo or a trio. I have the full band, and we do the full band thing as well. But a lot of times I'm playing in wonderful little theaters like the Sutter Creek Theater and the hotel up in Alturas, California, and here at the Red Dog Cafe, We have a wonderful place called the Red Dog Saloon where Janis Joplin used to play, up in Virginia City where I live. And we have a beautiful community center over in Yerington, Nevada. And we do really go all over with this duo and trio. And it's been wonderful to do the music that people want to hear from the old days and also introduce them to this new music, which I have had very good reception on the new music that I'm doing.
Well, that's great to hear. That's the way it should be. Well, I hope as you get these done, you'll make sure we get a copy, and I would love to get them on the air, and I'd love to have you back again to talk about that, too. It sounds very exciting.
You know, I'd love to send you, in fact, there is a link, and I can tell you after the interview how to get it if you want to, for the Last Wild Place anthology, but I'd love for you to have the package. So before we hang up, I would like to get your address and a way to send you the Last Wild Place anthology, because as I said, I think it's the best thing I've ever done.
Oh, thank you.
And we are going to be all over the place this year. We'll be in California and Indiana and Washington and Tennessee and Nevada and Utah and Montana and Missouri and Arizona. And there's stuff on the table looking like Mexico, Texas, and Idaho.
Oh, gosh.
So we will be everywhere. I don't see too many things I think about as east as we come is probably Indiana.
Well, that's not too far from me, so I can get down there for that.
That
I used to live there, so that's a good time to go back.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
Did you? Well, I really, you know, Scott, it's been a joy talking to you, and I hope we get to visit again, and I really appreciate your interest in what I'm doing, and I'm looking forward to meeting you in real life at the 20th anniversary of the awards.
Oh, me too. Looking forward to it. And again, folks, it's the North American Country Music Association's International 20th Anniversary, and tickets are at countrytonightpf.com or 1-800-792-4308, and of course, we have that information on our Facebook page as well. You're going to get to see Lacey J. Dalton and so much great talent down there. And Lacey, it's been a true pleasure talking with you. Thank you so much for taking time.
Well, I've really enjoyed talking with you, fellow animal person. And it'll be really fun to meet you and your family out there in Pigeon Forge March 17th.
Well, I'm looking forward to it. Folks, we're going to play 16th Avenue for you right now as we continue with My Kind of Country. Thank you again, Lacey J. Dalton.